Okay, these questions come from chapter 8 and 9. The numbering starts over again here, starting on question 1. This first question is from chapter 8.1, where we talked about parabolas in the context of conic sections. In that case, we didn't just graph a parabola with a vertex, we graphed a parabola with a vertex, a focus, and a directrix. We also had to place the equation in a slightly different form here. Instead of solving for y, when we're trying to graph a parabola as a conic section, you need to isolate the variable as being squared. So here you're going to subtract the 8y on the other side, and because it's the x variable that's being squared, it's going to be a vertical parabola. And this minus sign here is going to flip the parabola upside down, so this is an upside down vertical parabola. Now, negative 8 is the coefficient of y, so that's the value for p. And if you divide both sides by 4, you get a value of p equals negative 2. Now, since this is a vertical parabola, and there haven't been any transformations, what I mean by that is a parabola that's been transformed in conic section would look something along the lines of x minus h squared equals 4py minus k. Since we don't have an h or a k value, then we assume that the vertex is at the origin. So if the vertex is at the origin and it's an upside down vertical parabola, p equals negative 2 tells us that the focus is right there on the y-axis, so the focus is 0, comma, negative 2. Now, that also means that the directrix is the same distance from the vertex directly opposite the focus. So the directrix is going to be right up there going through the y-axis at positive 2. Now, the vertex is here at the origin, and the parabola is going to be opening up downward around the focus going through that vertex. What we need to know, though, is the exact width of the parabola. For that, we use the focal diameter. That was a segment that goes right through the focus. The focal diameter is found from this value right here. It's the absolute value of 4p. Plus have a value of negative 8. So the focal diameter is 8. That means it's split evenly. 4 from this focus on this side, 4 from the focus on that side, for a total distance of 8. So the parabola has that kind of shape. Question 2, an ellipse. This was studied in section 8.2. The vertices are negative 10, positive 10, comma 0. The foci, negative 4, positive 4, comma 0. Those are both on the x-axis, which leads us to believe this is a horizontal ellipse. And because of that, it needs to be of the form x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared equals 1. That's what the equation needs to look like. And if you remember, with an ellipse, A is supposed to be larger than B. And that's why the larger of the two is underneath the x variable, because this is a horizontal ellipse. Now, the foci tell us the value of C. So C is equal to plus or minus 4. The vertices tell us the value of A. So A is plus or minus 10. Now, if you square both sides here for a, we get a squared is equal to 100. Similarly, we get c squared is equal to 16. Now, the foci really would only help us if we were graphing this, because we'd have to know the location on the graph. But they're also helpful to find b squared, because the formula that relates a, b, and c on an ellipse is c squared equals a squared minus b squared. So we have 16 is equal to 100 minus b squared, which means that b squared is equal to 84. So we can replace a squared with 100, b squared with 84, and that's the equation of the ellipse that we need.
Okay, so this technique of tracing out an ellipse from a rectangular piece of plywood is actually used. There's two tacks right here, and then the carpenter pulls a string tight with his pencil like this, and then keeping the string tight will trace around the piece of plywood there, making an oval. And the tacks are located at the two foci. So two questions here. What is the distance between the two tacks, and what is the length of string? So let's deal with the tacks. Let's say we have some ellipse. And a piece of plywood that goes around it. And to make things easier, I'm going to have a graph. And that would be the center of the graph, right there. So this piece of plywood is 10 feet across, and it's 5 feet high. So if starting in the center and going to the outside, that would only be 5 feet. So one end here is the point 5 comma 0. The other end is the point negative 5 comma 0. So that makes a total length of 10 feet across. Now up here, if we're starting at the middle and moving to the very top, that'd be 2.5 feet. And then down here, this would be negative 2.5, making a total length of 5 feet for the width. Now foci, or the tacks, whenever we have graphed an ellipse, we've always called it C for the foci. We're trying to find C. So we've got to figure out where C, the values of C are. Now, we've been given the values of A and B. A is plus or minus 5. B is plus or minus 2.5. Trying to figure out C, so we can use the formula C squared equals A squared minus B squared. A squared would be 25, B squared would be 6.25. If you subtract the two, you get 18.75. And then take the square root on both sides. So one focus is a positive square root of 18.75 comma 0. The other one is negative square root of 18.75 comma 0. So the distance between them from tack to tack is twice the distance from the center to one of the tacks. So the distance from the center of the ellipse to one of the tacks is square root of 18.75. So two of those distances will be 2 square roots of 18.75. So the tacks are 2 square roots of 18.75 feet apart. If you were to type this into a calculator, it's about roughly 8.66 feet apart. Now we need the length of string. So there's string tied up to that tack, and there's a string tied up to that tack. And at one point, let's say that The carpenter has the pencil pulled all the way up to the very top of the ellipse. So we need to figure out length of string. Easiest way to do this, or an easy way, I don't know if it's the easiest way, but here's a way, is to cut this triangle in half and imagine a right triangle, and we're trying to find the hypotenuse of a right triangle. Because once we find this length, we can just double it for that length. So the formula for a right triangle to find a hypotenuse is a squared plus b squared equals c squared. It's Pythagorean's theorem. This length is from here to the tack is the square root of 18.75. This length is 2.5. So if we use Pythagorean's theorem, square root of 18.75 squared plus 2.5 squared is equal to the hypotenuse squared. Square is square root. The square root cancels, so you've got 18.75 plus 6.25 equals x squared. Add the two together, you get 25 equals x squared, so x equals 5, which also means that this side equals 5, so the length of string is 10 feet.
Question 4, graphing an ellipse given by this equation. Now, this is supposed to equal 1, so we need to divide everything by 16. So we have x squared over 16 plus y squared over 4 equals 1. On an ellipse, in the denominators in particular, you need to look for the largest value. Here at 16, it's underneath the x variable, which means this is a horizontal ellipse. Also means that this is a squared. So a is then equal to plus or minus 4. This is b squared, so b would equal plus or minus 2. So the a values are going to go on the x-axis because it's underneath the x variable. The y, or the b values are going to go on the y-axis. And we have our ellipse. We need to find the foci, so it's c squared equals a squared minus b squared. C squared is equal then to 12. C is equal to the square root of 12. The square root of 12 is an irrational number between 3 and 4. So, that right there, and right there, those are the location of two foci. And question 5, it says, find the center form of the conic. It's not identified which type of conic this is. We need to figure that out in the process of completing the square and writing this in standard form. So, I'm going to regroup these terms with like variables, the x's together, and then the y's together, and then complete the square. So this becomes 4x squared plus 40x minus 5y squared minus 30y. I'm going to add the 45 over to the other side, and it equals 45. Now if we complete the square on x, we have to factor out the 4. And then the value that makes this x squared plus 10x into a perfect square trinomial is going to be 25. So to keep the equation balanced, we really added 25 times 4. So we have to add 100. Now with the y variables, you factor out a 5, which leaves y squared plus 6y. Now the value here that completes the square is 9. 9 times negative 5 is a negative 45. Negative 45, positive 45 cancels, so right side is equal to 100. The left side factors into 4 times quantity x plus 5 squared minus 5 times the quantity y plus 3 squared. Excuse me. Now, this needs to equal 1 on the right side, so we can divide all the terms by 100, which gives us the rational expression x minus 5 squared, or x plus 5 squared, 425 minus y plus 3 squared, 420, is equal to 1. So we see now this is the equation of a hyperbola. Because there's a minus sign separating these two rational expressions, one's a positive, one's a negative. And with the hyperbolas, it doesn't matter in the denominator which one is larger, it matters which one is connected to the positive rational expression. This is the positive expression, it's with the x variable, so that means this is going to be a horizontal hyperbola. So this is a squared, again, not because it's larger, because it's connected to the positive fraction. So a squared is 25, a is n equal to plus or minus 5. This would be b squared, so then b is approximately plus or minus 4.3, maybe 4.4, somewhere around there, square root of 20. We have to remember now there's also been some transformations. X plus 5 is a shift to the left 5 units. Y plus 3 is a shift down 3 units. So that's going to be the center of our hyperbola. From this new center, we're going to go out horizontally 5 units. That's the A value. And vertically, we're going to go up 4.3 units. And that's going to help us draw the central box. And then using the central box, we can draw in the slanted asymptotes. And then the pieces of the hyperbola are going to be horizontal because this is a horizontal hyperbola. So there's a piece that fits there. That fits there. So that's what the graph of the hyperbola looks like. Now we need the foci. This equation is c squared equals a squared plus b squared. A squared is 25, b squared is 20. So adding the two gives 45. So c is approximately, well, square root of 45 is very, very close to the square root of 49, which is 7, so it's pretty close to 7, approximately 6.8. So starting from the center of this hyperbola, we're going to go out 6.8 units. So then there are the two foci. So with this hyperbola in question 6, the foci are given. The vertices are given. Since they're both on the x-axis, this is going to be the equation of a horizontal hyperbola, which is x squared over a squared minus y squared or b squared equals 1. Much like the problem on the page before, the foci give us the value of c. So then c squared would be 25. The vertices give us the value of a, so then a squared would be 16. Now if I'm b squared, we use the same formula that we did here. C squared is equal to a squared plus b squared. So then b squared is going to be c squared minus a squared. B squared then is 25 minus 16. B squared is equal to 9. So we knew x squared, or a squared rather, was 16. We now know b squared is 9. So there's the equation. B, the values of b are going to go on the y-axis. Using the values of a and b, now we can draw in the central box. Finish graphing the hyperbola.